3, 2, 1.
Well, welcome everybody. We're very glad to see you here this evening for these two follow-up lectures to the series that we did on the Great Prophetic Chain. Before we begin our study, we want to ask for the Lord's blessing. Never should we open God's Word without asking the Lord to come and explain it to us. And so I invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Father in heaven, we come before your throne, humbly realizing our limitations, that we need your wisdom in order to understand the passage that we are going to study in the next two evenings. So we ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit through the ministry of the angels. Give us understanding, Lord, that we might see the times that we're living in, and we might prepare for the trying events that soon will explode upon the world scene. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being here, and we claim your promise that you'll be with us, because we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. What I'd like to do as we begin is to review the prophetic chain that we studied during the 10-part series just recently. We began the chain by studying about which kingdom? Babylon. Very well. Then we moved on to Medo-Persia. Then we noticed that the next kingdom is Greece. The following kingdom is Rome. And then what happens to Rome? Rome is divided into 10 kingdoms. And then after Rome is divided into 10 kingdoms, you have a little horn that rises among the 10 and uproots 3. That's another Rome. Which Rome is that? It's Papal Rome. And Papal Rome rules for 1,260 years. And those years end at what date? 1798. Now, at the same time that this little horn or beast receives a deadly wound, another beast rises from the earth. And what is represented by that beast that rises from the earth when the first beast receives its deadly wound? That represents the United States of America. And the United States of America has two principles, which is civil and religious liberty, separation of church and state. And for the last 200 plus years, the United States has lived in harmony with those principles. But we also noticed that the beast from the earth, representing the United States, is going to be instrumental in returning power to the Roman Catholic papacy. And the papacy then will act as it did in the past. And then the final events of the drama will transpire upon this earth. Now, what we are going to study today is related very closely to God's prophetic chain. But it does not begin in the days of Babylon. What we are going to study begins in the times of the Roman Empire. In other words, we're not going to take a look at Babylon, Medo-Persia, and Greece, because the passage that we're going to study begins with the Roman Empire. And then we're going to move on. We're going to study events that take place during the Roman Empire. And then we're going to take a look at the rise of the little horn or the beast. Only in the passage that we're going to study, this power is not called the little horn of the beast. This power is called the man of sin. It's called the mystery of lawlessness. So in other words, it's the same power as the little horn and the beast, but the name of it is the man of sin. And then we're going to see that the man of sin will exist until Jesus comes to destroy this power. So basically, the time frame that we're going to look at is from the Roman Empire on until this power is destroyed by the brightness of the coming of Jesus. Now, with that in mind, we're going to go to the sheets that you have in your hands. I would recommend to those who will be watching this on television and who are watching the live stream, as well as YouTube, that you would acquire a copy of the syllabus for the Great Prophetic Chain, as well as for what we're studying today. Because you'll be able to read all of the texts and read all of the quotations from historians and from scholars about the different aspects that we've been studying about. So I would recommend that you get the syllabus. I want to make it clear that these two lectures that we're dealing with today and tomorrow are not technically part of the chain series. However, you'll see that they're very closely related to the chain series. So I would recommend that you get the chain series, which has 10 lectures, and also get these two because they complement one another. Now let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verses 15 through 17. Of course, the Apostle Paul established the work in Thessalonica. And notice what he says in his first epistle. This passage, by the way, is read almost at every funeral that I've ever attended. It says this: "For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." Verse 17, "Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them," that is with those who died and resurrected, "in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord." Now you notice in this passage that twice the Apostle Paul uses a very interesting expression. He says, "we who are alive and remain." And so you might get the impression that the Apostle Paul is telling the Thessalonians that they are going to be alive and remain until the second coming of Jesus. And they misunderstood what the Apostle Paul was saying. Paul was saying, we are alive and remain, we're going to be caught up with those who died and resurrected. He's not predicting that he and the Thessalonians are going to be alive and remain. But they misunderstood what he was saying, and they began to teach, some of them, that Jesus had come spiritually, or that the coming of Jesus was very, very imminent. It was about to take place. So the Apostle Paul had to write a second epistle, clearing up the misunderstanding they had, the belief that they had that Jesus was going to come in their day and all of the church was going to be alive and remain. And in the second epistle, the Apostle Paul writes in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 2, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming," that's a very important word, I want you to remember it, it's the Greek word parousia. Keep that in the back of your mind because it's a very key word. We're going to come back to it later on in this two-part series. So the Apostle Paul says, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit," that most likely means in a prophetic vision, "or by word," that would be an oral report from somebody, "or by letter," that would be a written communication, "as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come." So the Apostle Paul is saying, listen, if somebody comes to you and said that they had a vision, or they come to you and they say that they heard that the Apostle Paul said, or they even come with a written communication that has the signature of Paul on it, don't believe them if they're saying that the day of Christ has come or the day of Christ is even near, because they are going to deceive you. And so the Apostle Paul is making it very clear that Jesus is not going to come imminently like the Thessalonians believed at that time. Now the Apostle Paul then goes on in verse 3 and following to describe events that must take place before the parousia of Jesus. In other words, before the second coming of Christ. Now we're going to take this passage phrase by phrase, and we're going to try and determine the meaning of each one of these phrases. Are you understanding so far what we've looked at? So basically reviewing, the Apostle Paul mentioned we who are alive and remain. The Thessalonians said, oh, that means that we're going to be alive when Jesus comes. So Paul writes another epistle. The second epistle, he says, folks, you misunderstood me. I'm not predicting that we're going to be alive and remain. I'm just saying if we were alive and remain, we would be caught up. So he says, what I want you to know is that if anybody tells you that I said something, or somebody comes with a letter signed by me, or somebody comes and says that they had a vision showing that Jesus is even at the door, he's going to come in our time, don't believe them because they're deceivers. Now let's go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 3. The Apostle Paul says, "Let no one deceive you by any means." Now what would the deception be? In the light of what he said in the first two verses, what would the deception be? The idea that Jesus was going to come in the days of the Apostle Paul, that the coming of Jesus was imminent in that day. So he says, "Let no one deceive you by any means." For that day, what day is he referring to here? That day? The parousia, okay, the second coming of Jesus. For that day will not come, in other words, the coming of Jesus will not take place until something happens. Will not come unless what? The falling away comes what? First. So let me ask you, before the second coming of Jesus, must the apostasy come or must the falling away take place? Absolutely. So if you say that Jesus comes before the falling away or before the apostasy, you are going to be what? You're going to be deceived, is what the Apostle Paul is saying. And that's very important because many Christians today teach the rapture of the church. They say the church is going to be raptured away, and then after that, the Antichrist or the man of sin is going to appear and he's going to introduce the apostasy. The Apostle Paul says, hey, if you're teaching that the apostasy takes place before the second coming of Jesus, you are going to be what? Actually, after the second coming of Jesus, you are going to be deceived. Now, you'll notice in this note, this important note, that the Apostle Paul is not speaking about an apostasy. The Apostle Paul is speaking about the apostasy. It has the definite article. This is a specific apostasy that is found in the Old Testament, we're going to notice. The word apostasy, which is translated falling away in the New King James Version, is the Greek word apostasia. And of course, in English, we get the word apostasy from this. So falling away is apostasia. This word is not common in the New Testament, but it is used in classical Greek. And in classical Greek, it's used to describe a boat that is not well anchored at port. At first, it's at the port. But because it's not well anchored, it starts drifting away from the port into the sea. So basically, let me ask you, for the boat to drift away from the port, must the boat have been at the port at some point? Obviously. So it means that the church, the apostolic church, was at the port, so to speak, and there was going to be a what? An apostasy or a falling away from the apostolic gospel, because the church was at port, so to speak, originally. Now, this is not, as I mentioned once again, is not an apostasy. This is the apostasy. Now, let's continue studying the phrases that the Apostle Paul uses. He says, let no one deceive you by any means. For that day, that is the day of the coming of Jesus, will not come unless the falling away comes first. So the apostasy comes first before the parousia, before the second coming of Jesus. And then it says, the apostasy is characterized by a power that is called what? And the man of sin is revealed. So this apostasy is called the man of sin. Now, the question is then, what is sin? If we want to know what the man of sin represents, we have to find a definition of sin. Now, the best definition, actually the only definition that I can find in Scripture of sin, is found in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. And I'm reading from the New King James Version, but I'm also going to mention what the King James Version says as well. 1 John 3, 4 defines sin. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. And sin is lawlessness. Now, you know the King James Version reads that whoever sins transgresses also the law, for sin is what? Sin is the transgression of the law. So in some way, this power is going to encourage people to what? Is going to encourage people to break God's law. It is going to be a power that is going to encourage people to sin. Are you following me or not? Now, would this be parallel to something that the little horn thought that he could do? Do you remember what the little horn thought that it could do? It thought that it could change what? God's law. So if you keep the law as it was changed by this little horn power, would you be transgressing the law? Yes, you would. And so the man of sin and the little horn have a common characteristic. One is called the man of lawlessness a little bit later on in this passage. the man of sin, and sin is the transgression of the law, which means that this power is going to encourage people in some way to transgress the holy law of God. In fact, let's read Daniel chapter 7 and verse 25, speaking about the little horn, which we notice is the same as the beast, and what we're discussing, the man of sin. The man of sin is the same as the little horn and the beast. We read this: he shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and what? And law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time, and times, and half a time. So we notice that the man of sin is going to be characterized by transgressing God's holy law. In some way, he is going to encourage people to be disobedient to the law of God. Now, let's move on in this passage. We're interpreting phrase by phrase, almost word by word, as we study along. Once again, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 3 says, "Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day," that is the day of the coming of Jesus, "will not come unless the falling away," or the apostasy, a specific apostasy, because it's the little horn apostasy that Paul is talking about, "unless the falling away or the apostasy comes first, and the man of sin is" what? "Is revealed." Let me ask you, what is the antonym of revealed? What is the opposite? Revealed and concealed. Exactly. So let me ask you this. In the days of the Apostle Paul, was the man of sin concealed? Yes. Because he says the day of Jesus will not take place, the second coming will not take place until the man of sin is what? Revealed. So in the days of the Apostle Paul, this power must have been what? Must have been under the radar. It must have been concealed. But was there a specific time in which the man of sin was going to manifest himself? We're going to notice a little bit later on, the passage says that he would rise in his time. Does the prophecy of Daniel 7 speak about a specific time when the little horn was going to rule? Time, times, and the dividing of time. Are you seeing the parallel expressions between 2 Thessalonians 2 and Daniel chapter 7? We're going to notice a little bit later on in this passage, it says that this man of sin would rise or would be revealed in his time. But in the days of the Apostle Paul, this power had not totally revealed itself. It was undercover, or it was stealthy, if you please. Now, the Apostle Paul had already spoken about apostasy rising in the church in his day. Notice Acts chapter 20 and verses 28 to 30. Here he is speaking to the elders of Ephesus, and he is warning them about apostasies to enter, not the apostasy, but apostasies to enter the church during his very lifetime. It says there in Acts chapter 20, verse 28, "Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock, among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers." That's episkopoi, the word that is used, where we get the word bishop from. So it says, "Therefore take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock." And now notice this, "and also from among yourselves." Wow, he's speaking to them, he's saying, "some of you will rise up speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves." So was the apostasy fully manifested in the days when the Apostle Paul was writing? No, it was concealed. It was under the radar. But the time would come when the man of sin would be what? The man of sin would be openly revealed for what he was. Now let's move on in our study of these verses. So far, so good? Now let's notice 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 3 once again. "Let no one deceive you by any means. For that day," that is the day of the coming of Jesus, "will not come unless the apostasy comes first." This is the little horn apostasy or the beast apostasy. "And the man of sin," that is a power that is going to encourage people to transgress the law of God, "is revealed," which means that in the days of Paul, the man of sin was concealed, And then he calls this power by another name. Not only is this power called the man of sin, but this power is called the what? It's called the son of perdition. What an interesting name. The man of sin, the son of perdition. Now, how do we understand this name, the son of perdition? Well, the fact is, folks, that this name is used only one other time in all of the New Testament. In fact, in all of the Bible. And that is in John chapter 17 and verse 12. Let's go to John 17 verse 12 and notice to whom this name belonged. It says there, and Jesus is speaking in his prayer to his Father, "While I was with them," that is, while I was with the apostles, "I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept. And none of them is lost except whom? The son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled." So who is the only other person in the Bible who is defined by the expression the son of perdition? Judas Iscariot. Now listen carefully. In the Bible, names are vitally important. Names are not simply to distinguish one person from another, like many times today. Names in the Bible denote the character of the person that bears the name. The name has to do with character. And you know, in the Bible, this appears many, many times. Nebuchadnezzar changed the names of the three young men because he didn't want them to have to reflect the character of the Hebrew God. He wanted them to reflect the character of the gods of Babylon. You know, in the book of Genesis, you have time and again the importance of a name, Peniel, which means the face of God. You know, Yahweh Jireh, the Lord will provide. You know, whenever the character of the place or individual is emphasized, a name is given. Now, let me read you from the Interpreter's Dictionary of the Bible, volume 3, pages 500 and 501, what the meaning of a name is. It says there, "In biblical thought, a name is not a mere label of identification. It is an expression of the essential nature of its bearer. A man's name reveals his what? Reveals his character." And then he gives an example. "Adam was able to give names to the beasts and birds because, as Milton says, he understood their what? He understood their nature." And so, if this man of sin is called the son of perdition, that name, son of perdition, which is given to Judas, must mean that he has a character similar to whom? Similar to Judas. Similar to Judas Iscariot. Now, there's a character of Judas and the character of the man of sin are very similar. So would it help us to understand the character of Judas Iscariot in order to understand the manifestation of the man of sin? Absolutely. Now, let's talk about the nature of the Antichrist. There's a fundamental misconception in the Christian world today, particularly among conservative Christians. And that is that they think that the Antichrist is a nasty individual opposed to Christianity who is going to rebuild the Jewish temple. And after the Jewish temple is rebuilt, he's going to sit in the temple. He's going to blaspheme the God of heaven. For 3.5 years, he's going to persecute the Jews, and all this will take place supposedly after the rapture of the church. So everybody is looking to the Middle East for the rebuilding of the Jewish temple, for the rise of the man of sin, or for the rise of the Antichrist. That is a misconception about the nature of the Antichrist. And you say, why is that? Well, let me mention, first of all, that the Antichrist cannot be a specific individual, one person. It can't be one person. And you say, why can't it be one person? There are several reasons. Reason number one is that practically all Bible scholars agree that the little horn, the beast, and the man of sin all represent the same power. They represent the papacy. The papacy is called the little horn, the beast, and the man of sin. Now, if the beast is the same as the little horn and the man of sin, then let me ask you, what does a beast represent in Bible prophecy? Does a beast represent an individual person in Bible prophecy? No. Beasts represent what? Kingdoms or empires. So in other words, the man of sin, if he's the same as the little horn and the beast, cannot be an individual person. It must be a system, because beasts in Scripture represent not individual kings. They represent what? They represent systems, global systems. There's a second reason, and that is that prophecy tells us that this man of sin, or the little horn, or the beast, whatever way you want to call him, ruled for 1,260 years. You know, I don't know anyone who has lived 1,260 years who could be defined as the Antichrist. So obviously it cannot be an individual if this man of sin or beast ruled for 1,260 years, 42 symbolic months, or time times and the dividing of time in a symbolic sense. Furthermore, we notice that this power was restrained in the days of the Apostle Paul, but was there, wanting to show its full power, wanting to reveal itself. But the prophecy says that this power will be destroyed at the second coming of Jesus. Now, do you know anyone who was alive in the days of the Apostle Paul who will be destroyed at the second coming of Jesus Christ, who lived all during that period of time? Of course not. It would be an impossibility. So if this power was wanting to manifest itself in the days of the Apostle Paul, it was underground, and it's going to be destroyed at the second coming of Jesus Christ, it must mean that it can't be a literal person. It has to be a system, because from the days of Paul till the second coming of Christ is too long a time for an individual to be represented by this prophecy. Are you understanding my point? Now, there's another reason. See, they say, it says the man of sin. So the man of sin means one particular man. Well, that sounds persuasive until you notice that in Scripture the expression is used to refer not only to individuals, it is used to refer also to systems. For example, if you read Hebrews 9 verse 7, and you know you have this in your syllabus, I didn't quote all of the verses in the syllabus, but if you go to Hebrews 9 verse 7, it uses the expression the priest. It's not talking about a specific priest. It's talking about all of the priests of the Hebrew system. So the priest, singular, describes a whole succession of priests in the whole history of Israel. You'll also notice in 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 11 that the expression the king does not refer to an individual king, but it refers to the succession of all of the kings of Israel and of Judah. So the king, which is singular with a definite article, can mean the whole succession of kings. The priest does not mean one specific priest, it means an entire succession of priests. And then in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 17, you have the expression the man of God. Now if you read that text, it's not talking about one specific man. It's talking about everyone who reads the Scriptures. And so just because it says the man of sin does not necessarily mean that it is an individual person rather than a system, because the singular noun with the definite article can refer to a succession of individuals rather than a specific individual. Now, the Scriptures clearly show that the Antichrist will be a political religious system possessing the identical character qualities of Judas. It will be ambitious, covetous of power and money, desirous of an earthly kingdom, while overtly professing loyalty to Christ. It will work covertly to betray Jesus Christ. Is that a good description of Judas? So if the man of sin is called the son of perdition, the same name that Judas had, would his character be similar to the character of Judas, the power? Absolutely. Now, Dave Hunt, who, by the way, I disagree with on almost everything. He's a futurist. He believes in this theory of a rebuilt Jewish temple. He died a few years ago. And, you know, the Antichrist, a blasphemous individual sitting in the temple and persecuting the Jews for 3.5 literal years, etc. You know, he has this quotation where he has the picture of the Antichrist correct. This is how it reads. Global Peace, pages 7 and 8. While the prefix anti generally means against or opposed to, it can also mean in the place of or a substitute for. The Antichrist will embody both meanings. He will oppose Christ while pretending to be Christ. Is that a pretty good picture? Instead of a frontal attack against Christianity, the evil one will pervert the church from within by posing it as its founder. Now, of course, he's referring to a specific individual. That's what he believes. But we know the system has these characteristics. He continues writing. He will cunningly misrepresent Christ while pretending to be Christ. And right here is where the plot thickens. If the Antichrist will indeed pretend to be the Christ, then his followers must be Christians. Is this a pretty good picture? Absolutely. It's the true picture of Antichrist, only that Dave Hunt thinks that it's going to be a specific future individual who's going to sit in a rebuilt Jewish temple, while really the scriptures teach that this is not a specific individual. This is a system composed of an entire succession of rulers or individuals. Now, it's interesting that the Greek word Antichrist, which is antichristos, and the expression vicarius Christi, that is vicar of Christ, basically mean the same thing. Antichrist means in place of Christ. And vicarius Christi also means in place of Christ. So, and by the way, vicarius Christi is the name that the popes generally use for themselves now. Vicarius Christi. It means one who occupies the place of Christ. Is that the definition of Antichrist, claiming to take the place of Christ? Absolutely. You know, we usually think of anti as being against. But in the New Testament, the preposition anti, when it's attached to a noun, many times means in place of, not against. And you have several examples here in the syllabus. In classical Greek, the word antibasileus, basileus is king. Antibasileus means somebody who rules in place of the king. Not someone who is against the king, but someone who rules in place of the king. You have the word or the name Antipas. Have you heard of the name Antipas? Antipas, the word pas is father. So Antipas means one who rules in place of the Father, not against the Father, one who rules in place of the Father. You know, we all know the word antichrist or the word antitype, right? What does the word antitype mean? Well, the type would be the lamb, right? The sacrifice of the lamb. The antitype or the fulfillment would be Jesus Christ, the sacrifice of the true lamb. So let me ask you, does the antitype take the place of the type? Yes. So when Jesus comes, the death of Christ takes the place of the sacrifice of the Lamb. It doesn't mean that anti-type, he's going against the type. It means that he's fulfilling the type or he's taking the place of the type. So the preposition anti does not necessarily mean against Christ. We're not to expect an antichrist who blasphemes Jesus and attacks him personally. You know, we're to look for someone who claims to occupy the position and the place of Christ. Incidentally, there's another interesting word in the New Testament, the word anti-lutron. And basically, that the text that we find is 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 6, where it says that Jesus gave his life a ransom in place of many. Not against many, but in place of many. And the word that is used there is anti-lutron, which means in place of. So is this point clear? That when we talk about someone who is the Antichrist, it's not someone who is opposed to Christ, it is someone who claims to occupy the position of Christ. So the Antichrist will not be an atheistic and blasphemous individual only attacking openly attacking Christianity, but someone who claims to occupy the place of Christ and operates in the name of Christ. As you probably know, Francis I is the first Jesuit pope in the history of the Roman Catholic Church. And he is a very interesting individual. I want to read you this statement from the Spirit of Prophecy, Great Controversy 234 and 235, on the modus operandi of Roman Catholicism and particularly its bishops or its pope. It says there, when appearing as members of their order, they wore a garb of what? Is that deceptive? Is that openly defying Christ and going against Christ? No, no, no. It says, when appearing as members of their order, they wore a garb of sanctity. Visiting what? Is that what Francis has been doing? Yes, visiting prisons and what else? Hospitals. Ministering to whom? We're seeing this happen. Ministering to the sick and the poor. Professing to have what? Renounced the world. And bearing what? The sacred name of Jesus. Not against Jesus, bearing the sacred name of Jesus. Who went about doing what? Doing good. But under this blameless exterior, remember that the Antichrist was concealed in the days of Paul? Was he openly manifesting himself? No, he was concealed. Was he going to reveal himself openly later on? Yes. She says, but under this blameless exterior, the most criminal and deadly purposes were, there's the key word, were concealed. The best description that I have ever read on the Roman Catholic papacy is in the book Great Controversy, page 571. And by the way, when I talk about the papacy, remember I'm not talking about the specific individuals in the Roman Catholic Church. We're dealing with the papacy as a system. There are many sincere, loving Christians in the Roman Catholic Church. They serve God to the best of their knowledge. They love Jesus with all their hearts, but they just don't have all the light. And God accepts their best service according to the light that they have received. But it is our role to point them out, point out these prophecies so that they can have a fuller relationship with Jesus Christ, so that they can embrace the entire truth. So we're not referring to everyone who belonged to the Roman Catholic system. We're referring to the system itself. This is the statement. It is a part of her, that is the papacy's policy, to assume the character which will best accomplish her purpose. But beneath the variable appearance of the chameleon. Do you know what a chameleon is? It's a lizard that changes colors depending on the environment on which it is found. Interesting. So if it's in a green on greenery, it looks green. If it's on a brown twig, it looks brown. It adapts to its environment. So it is part of her policy to assume the character which will best accomplish her purpose. But beneath the variable appearance of the chameleon, notice beneath, stealth, secret, she conceals what? She conceals the invariable venom of the serpent. So we're talking about the name that this system has. Not only the man of sin, encouraging people to disobey God's law in some sense, we're also talking about a system that is called the son of perdition, and the son of perdition is the name that is given to whom? To Judas. So would it be a good idea for us to study the character of Judas to know what the Antichrist is going to be like? Of course, if they have the same name, it's because they have the same character. Because in the Bible, names indicate character. Now, how then does the Bible portray Judas, the son of perdition? The Gospels portray Judas as a shrewd politician and a sharp businessman who carried the money bag and craved the praise of the world. I'm going to read you now three statements from Ellen White where she describes the character of Judas. The first is found in the book Education, page 93. He had come more into contact with the world than they, that is, than the other disciples. He was a man of good address, of discernment, and executive ability. And having a high estimate of his own qualifications, he had led the disciples to hold him in the same regard. But the methods he desired to introduce into Christ's work were based upon what? Worldly principles, and were controlled by worldly policy. Is that a good description of the Roman Catholic papacy today? It most certainly is. In another statement that we find in the Seventh-day Adventist Bible Commentary, page 1001 and 1002, she states, but Judas was a speculator. He thought that he could manage the finances of the church, and by his sharpness in business, get what? Gain. He was divided in heart. He loved what? the praise of the world. Are we seeing this of the leader of the papacy? Absolutely. He refused to give up the world for Christ. He never committed his eternal interest to Christ. He had a superficial religion, and therefore he speculated upon his master and betrayed him to the priests. Being fully persuaded that Christ would not allow himself to be taken, Judas was a religious fraud. He held up a high standard for others, but he himself utterly failed to reach the Bible standard. He did not bring the religion of Christ into his life. In other words, he was a sham. He was a hypocrite. He appeared one way, but in the depths of his heart, he was totally different. In Desire of Ages, page 717, we find this statement. Judas summed up all the disciples and flattered himself that the church would often be brought into perplexity and embarrassment if it were not for his ability as a manager. Judas regarded himself as the capable one who could not be overreached. In his own estimation, he was an honor to the cause, and as such, he always represented himself. Judas coveted an earthly kingdom. Is that what the papacy covets today? How many of you have ever heard Francis I refer to the second coming of Christ as the great hope of humanity? Not once. Because in Roman Catholicism, establishing Christ's kingdom does not mean the second coming of Jesus to establish his kingdom. It means the Roman Catholic Church taking control of the civil powers of the world and establishing a theocracy on earth. That is the Roman Catholic view. Since the days of St. Augustine, he died, by the way, in year 431, so this is early in the history of the Christian Church. So the papacy would not speak about the second coming of Christ as the kingdom. The kingdom is the church taking over the reins of civil power, influencing the civil powers to establish Christ's kingdom where? Christ's kingdom on the earth. And so Judas constantly coveted an earthly kingdom. In fact, you remember when Jesus fed the 5,000. You know, Judas, we find in the Spirit of Prophecy, and also if you read the last few verses of John chapter 6, Judas was the one who instigated the people to try and take Jesus and force him to become a king. Let's read from the book of John chapter 6 and verse 15. After he fed the 5,000, we're told, therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him, how? By force, to make him king. He departed again to the mountain by himself alone. Ellen White explains that it was Judas who was the ringleader of this movement to make Jesus an earthly king to take over the civil power of the world rather than leading his spiritual kingdom. In Desire of Ages, page 718 and 719, we find this description of Judas. Judas was first to take advantage of the enthusiasm excited by the miracle of the loaves. It was he who set on foot the project to take Christ by force and make him king. His hopes were high, and his disappointment was bitter when Jesus left and he said, "My kingdom is not of this world." He rejected the kingdom from the Mount of Temptation. The devil offered him the kingdom. Jesus said, "No way, I didn't come for that. I came to lead a spiritual kingdom." We find also on the same pages, 718 and 719 of Desire of Ages, Ellen White explains, notwithstanding the Savior's own teaching, Judas was continually advancing the idea that Christ would reign as king in Jerusalem. At the feeding of the 5,000, he tried to bring this about. Notice that he was continually advancing the idea that Christ should become the king of this world. And in Desire of Ages, page 645, we find this statement. This is regarding the moment when Jesus washed the feet of the disciples. When Jesus did that, it broke the last link of sympathy between Judas and Christ. Judas said, "There's no future with this man." Notice the statement. If Jesus could so humble himself, he thought, he could not be Israel's king. All hope of worldly honor in a temporal kingdom was destroyed. Judas was satisfied that there was nothing to be gained by following Christ. after seeing him degrade himself as he thought, he was confirmed in his purpose to disown him and confess himself deceived. He was possessed by a demon. We'll come back to that a little bit later. And he resolved to complete the work he had agreed to do in betraying his Lord. So one of the characteristics of Judas is that he wanted an earthly kingdom with Jesus ruling the kingdoms of this world. He wanted power and he wanted fame. Was he also a lover of money? He most certainly was. In fact, you remember that Judas offered his services to Jesus. He was the one who said, "I'll follow you, Lord." And Jesus said, "You know, foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have any place to lay his head." Ellen White explains that he was trying to discourage Judas from following him. But Judas said, you know, he had seen Jesus, and he said, you know, there might be a financial future in this. Notice John chapter 12, verses 4 through 6. Here we catch glimpses of Judas's covetousness for money. It says there in John 12, verse 4 through verse 6, "But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, 'Why was this fragrant oil?'" This is when the woman broke the alabaster box and anointed the feet of Jesus with this expensive perfume. "Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and what? And given to the poor?" He was talking about himself. He had no regard for the poor. He just gave an impression that he was for the poor. Verse 6, "This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a what? He was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was put in it." We all know that Judas betrayed Jesus for what? For money. He was money hungry. He was power hungry. He wanted an earthly kingdom. Although we're going to notice that he professed to follow Christ until the very end. We're going to come to that. Notice Luke chapter 22 and verses 3 through 6. "Then Satan entered Judas, surnamed Iscariot, who was numbered among the 12. So he went his way and conferred with the chief priests and captains how he might betray him to them. And they were glad and agreed to give him what? Money. So he promised and sought the opportunity to betray him to them in the absence of the multitude." Ellen White amplifies the desire that Judas had for money in the book Desire of Ages, page 716. Judas had naturally a strong love for money, but he had not always been corrupt enough to do such a deed as this, that is to betray Jesus for money. He had fostered the evil spirit of avarice until it had become the ruling motive of his life. The love of mammon, that is of money, overbalanced his love for Christ. Through becoming the slave of one vice, he gave himself to Satan to be driven to any lengths in sin. In fact, in our next section, we're going to notice that Judas became the vicar of Satan, the representative of Satan, although he claimed to be a follower of Christ. Notice John chapter 6, 70 and 71. This is why we know that Judas was the ringleader there in John chapter 6, because at the end of the chapter we see who was behind it. It says in John 6, verse 70, "Jesus answered them," he's speaking to his disciples, "Did I not choose you, the 12, and one of you is a what? Is a devil." Would he ever have admitted that he was a devil? Did he openly show himself that he was a devil? No, absolutely not. He claimed that he was trying to defend Christ's kingdom and wanted the best. Verse 71, "He spoke of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for it was he who would what? Betray him, being one of the 12. Now, before the Last Supper, Judas still had an opportunity to repent. In other words, Judas was trying to take possession of his heart. Notice what we find in John chapter 13 and verse 2. This is before the Last Supper. It says there, "And supper," let's see here. "And supper being ended," this is, by the way, they had supper, and then Jesus washed the feet, and then they had the Lord's Supper. So we need to understand what the sequence is. So it says, "And supper being ended, the devil having already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. So you see, they have supper, that's the regular meal, and then Satan puts it in the heart of Judas to betray Christ. And then you'll read there in John chapter 13, Jesus washes the feet, and then they go back to the table and they celebrate the Lord's Supper. And at this point it says that the devil had put into the heart of Judas to betray Jesus. But now I want you to notice what happens at the end of the Last Supper, John 13 and verse 27. It says, now after the piece of bread, do you notice the difference here? Satan what? Satan entered him. Then Jesus said to him, what you do, do quickly. And it's interesting to notice what Ellen White had to say here. She says, Judas became a what? A representative of the enemy of Christ. What does the word representative mean? It means it's the same as the word vicar. He became the representative of whom? Of Satan. In other words, what he did was directly because he was possessed by Satan. He was possessed by the devil. Now, did Judas openly reveal that he was opposed to Christ all during the ministry of Christ? No, never. During the entire ministry of Jesus, he was concealed as an enemy of Christ. Like the man of sin, he did not reveal his true character until the very end. He constantly worked at cross purposes with Jesus, claiming to support him. As with the man of sin, his opposition was underhanded. It was not open, it was undercover. Judas, in other words, had the variable appearance of the what? Of the chameleon. He did not openly war against Jesus, but as Ellen White explains it, and I quote, he manifested a continuous, what kind? Secret and what else? Subtle antagonism. Does that sound like the man of sin? Absolutely. Ellen White also explains in the book The Sanctified Life, page 59, Judas possessed a form of godliness, while his character was more satanic than divine. Does the papacy claim a form of godliness? All you have to do is go to their cathedrals and look at all the ceremonies that are held in the church and so on. You know, this claims to be a perfectly Christian religious system. So she says Judas possessed a form of godliness, while his character was more what? More satanic than divine. He professed to be a disciple of Christ, but in words and in works he what? He denied him. You know, there's a very interesting detail that is mentioned by Ellen White in The Desire of Ages, page 644. She speaks about the positioning of the disciples at the Last Supper. John was seated at the right hand of Christ. Judas was seated at his left hand. You know, in the Bible, the right side is the side of God's favor. That's why Jesus always sits at the what? At the right hand of God. The left hand is the sinister side. In fact, in Spanish, it's called the siniestra. It's the sinister side. You remember the parable of the sheep and the goats? Where does Jesus place the sheep, his followers? He places them on his right side. Where does he place the goats who are the lost? He places them on his left side. It's very significant then, the positioning of John, the beloved disciple who wrote the book of Revelation, is at the right side of Jesus, whereas Judas is found at the left side of Jesus. Did Judas have the disciples deceived till the very end? Was he concealed till the very end? Yes, but at the very end, of course, you know, for Judas, it was too late. Do you remember when Jesus said at the table, one of you is going to betray me this evening? They all started asking what? Is it I? Is it I? Did Judas know that it was him? Of course he knew that it was him. But notice what we find in Matthew 26 and verse 25. Then Judas, who was betraying him, answered and said, Rabbi, is it I? He said to him, you have said it. And the disciples didn't get it. Even to that moment, they didn't understand what Jesus was saying. In fact, let's go to John 13, verses 26 to 29. He had his colleagues deceived till the very end. We find here in these verses, Jesus answered, he's speaking to his disciples at the Last Supper, "It is he to whom I shall give a piece of bread when I have dipped it." And having dipped the bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Now after the piece of bread, what happened? We talked about this. Satan entered him. You know, is it any coincidence? Let me just make a parenthesis here. Is it any coincidence that in Revelation chapter 13, the beast system that persecutes the saints of the Most High is called the beast? But in Revelation chapter 12, the same power that persecutes the woman is called what? The dragon. So in other words, the beast is the emissary of whom? Of the dragon. It's like, let me ask you, what was Pharaoh? Did Pharaoh act on his own to try and kill the deliverer, Moses? No. He's called the great dragon in Ezekiel 29 verse 3. He is not the dragon, he is an instrument in the hands of the dragon. Is the same true with the birth of Christ? Did the devil stand next to Mary to try and devour Christ when Christ was born? No. The devil is using Herod, the Roman ruler, to try and get rid of Jesus. Are you understanding me? And so Judas becomes the instrument in the hands of Satan. He's possessed by the devil. So it continues saying, verse 27, "Now after the piece of bread, Satan entered him. Then Jesus said to him, 'What you do, do quickly.'" Disciples didn't get it. Notice verse 28. "But no one at the table knew for what reason he said this to him. For some thought, because Judas had the money box, that Jesus had said to him, 'Buy those things we need for the feast,' or that he should give something to the poor." Till the very end he was concealed. He was not openly revealed. Is this true of the man of sin or of the Antichrist? Are you starting to catch a picture of the character of the man of sin? The character of this power that is called the little horn, that is called the beast? How did Judas betray Jesus Christ? Judas betrayed Jesus Christ with what? With a kiss. Wow. Interesting way to betray Christ. It says in Luke 22, verses 47 and 48, and this is in the garden when they come to arrest, the temple guard comes to arrest Jesus. "And while he was still speaking, behold, a multitude, and he who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near to Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, 'Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?'" Till the very end, Judas deceived the disciples and eventually betrays Christ and delivers him to death by giving him a kiss. Did Judas go to perdition? He most certainly did. Notice what we find in Matthew 27 and verses 3 through 5. "Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been condemned, was remorseful and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, 'I have sinned by betraying innocent blood.' And they said, 'What is that to us? You see to it.' Then he threw down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself." Now, when you read the scriptures, you find two descriptions of the death of Judas, and they appear to be contradictory. But the Bible doesn't contradict itself. The contradictions are only in our brain, because we're not able to reconcile passages that have a perfect explanation. Here it says that Judas went and hung himself. But if you read Acts chapter 1, it says there that he fell headlong from a high place, and when he fell to the ground, his belly exploded and his innards came out. And Ellen White says that a little later that day, when Jesus was on the way to Calvary, that the dogs were eating the body of Judas. And so you say, well, how do you understand this? You know, he fell headlong and his belly exploded and the innards came out. And then it says in Matthew that he hung himself. Well, Ellen White gives just a beautiful explanation. She says that Judas placed the rope over a branch, and Judas, you know, he probably jumped off the ledge. And when he jumped off the ledge, the rope broke, and he fell a long distance to the ground, and his belly exploded and his innards came out. And so we know that he was intending to hang himself, but he fell and his belly split open and the innards came out. Perfect way of reconciling two apparently contradictory passages of Scripture. So he ended up in perdition, just like the man of sin will end up in perdition at the end of time. So let's summarize then the characteristics that we've studied so far about Judas. He was a shrewd politician and administrator. He coveted political power and desired Christ to take over an earthly kingdom. He was covetous of money and earthly display and position. He feigned an interest for the poor. He became the vicar, a representative of Satan. His hypocrisy deceived only even those of his inner circle. He betrayed Jesus with a very kiss. In other words, he was an enemy not from outside, but from where? From inside, who feigned a love for Jesus. So is the Antichrist some external individual who blasphemes Christ and attacks Christianity from outside? No. It is a system that professes Christ, just like Judas, but betrays Jesus Christ. Is that true of the Roman Catholic papacy? It most certainly is true of the Roman Catholic papacy. Now let's move on in our study. We are told that this Antichrist, in 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 4, opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped. Now let me ask you this. Did the little horn claim to occupy the place of God? Of course. Did the little horn claim that it could change God's law? So who would be the only one who could change his law? God. So does the little horn claim to have the prerogative of God? The beast of Revelation 13, does that beast demand worship? Sure. The third angel's message says, if anyone worships the beast or his image and receives the mark. So the beast asks for worship. So if he asks for worship, must he claim to be God? Does this system claim to be God, the man of sin? Are we dealing, is the little horn and the beast and the man of sin the same power? It is exactly the same power, claiming worship. Now how do we understand this, that this man of sin would oppose and exalt himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped? What does it mean that he would oppose God? Most conservative Protestant scholars today see the Antichrist, as I mentioned before, as someone who will openly defy God. But the character of Judas shows us that the opposition is not overt, the opposition is covert. Judas professed to love Jesus and to support him, but stealthily he what? He opposed him secretly. In other words, the greatest enemies of Jesus were those who professed to serve God and did not. For example, do you remember Saul of Tarsus? Did Saul of Tarsus claim to serve the true God? Did he claim to believe in the true God? Most certainly he did. But was he opposing God? Would he ever have admitted that he was opposing God? No. He was opposing God while he claimed to be what? To be defending God. Notice John chapter 16 and verse 2. John 16 and verse 2. The fact that the man of sin opposes God doesn't mean that it's some blasphemous power that is openly opposed to God. Because you can oppose God while you claim to serve him. Notice John 16 verse 2. Jesus is speaking to his disciples and to those who would live afterwards. They will put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whoever kills you will think that he offers God service. So is a time coming when God's faithful people will be persecuted and those who are the persecutors will think that they're doing God a service, that they're serving God? Of course. But are they opposing God? They most certainly are opposing God. You know, let's take another example from the Bible. See, evangelicals, they say, see, he is opposed to God, so he must openly reject God and blaspheme God. No, no, because you can oppose God while you claim to serve him. Do you remember when the Sanhedrin got together to decide what they were going to do with Peter and John after the day of Pentecost? They deliberated. They actually wanted to kill them. And a wise man by the name of Gamaliel, who was Paul's teacher, by the way, stood up and he said something very interesting. It's found in Acts 5, 38 and 39. And now I say to you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For it is if this plan or this work is of men, it will come to nothing. But if it is of God, you cannot overthrow it, lest you even be found to fight against God. Would they have ever admitted that they were fighting against God by killing John and Peter? Are you kidding? Were they opposing God? Yes. Would they ever admit that they were opposing God? No. They opposed God while they claimed to what? While they claimed to serve Him. Ellen White, in the book Education, page 92, explains, Judas manifested a continuous, secret, and subtle antagonism against Christ. But did he claim to be a follower of Christ till the very end? Most certainly. She also states in Great Controversy 495, working, and this is speaking about Lucifer in heaven, it's not speaking about Judas, but remember, Lucifer or Satan possessed Judas, so they must have had the same character. She says, working with mysterious secrecy, and for a time what? Concealing his real purpose under what? An appearance of reverence for God. Was Judas the same as Lucifer in heaven? Is the papal system the same as Judas and Lucifer in heaven? Claiming to serve God, giving that picture to the world, and the whole world deceived, and yet underground working to overthrow the kingdom of Christ. Now, let's continue here. It speaks about this man of sin sitting in the temple of God. Now let's talk first of all, what does it mean when he sits in the temple of God? We need to understand that this does not refer to him literally sitting on some throne in a rebuilt Jewish temple. We need to understand what it means for him to sit. Let's read the verse and then we will interpret. This is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 4. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits, it's the word kathizo, that's an important word, he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is what? Showing himself that he is God. So he sits in the temple of God and he claims to be God. Now what does it mean that he sits in the temple of God? Well, the Greek word is the word kathizo, and the noun is kathedra, that is throne. The word kathedra is throne. The verb is kathizo. Now, how do we understand him sitting in the temple of God? Well, we need to go to Matthew 23 and verse 2 and compare what was occurring in the days of Christ. Did the religious leaders in the days of Christ sit somewhere and claim the authority, the infallible authority to teach? Yes, they did. Notice Matthew 23 verse 2. This is the rebuke of Jesus against the scribes and Pharisees. The scribes and Pharisees what? Sit in Moses' seat. By the way, the word seat there is the word cathedra. That, have you ever heard the word ex cathedra? We're going to come to that in a moment. What ex cathedra means. The word that is used here for seat is cathedra. So basically it says the scribes and Pharisees kathizo on the cathedra. Now what does that mean? Basically what it means is that in the days of Christ, the scholars of the Jewish nation believed that they have had the authority of Moses to teach infallibly, and their teachings had to be accepted as infallible. They believed that there was a succession all the way from the days of Moses till the times of Christ, and that oral tradition was passed on from generation to generation in a faithful way, in such a manner that what they taught, even though it wasn't in the scriptures, it needed to be accepted as gospel truth and infallible because they were speaking from Moses' seat or from Moses' throne. Let me ask you, does the Roman Catholic papacy claim that when the Pope speaks ex cathedra, that means from the throne, he speaks infallibly. Does the Roman Catholic Church believe in apostolic succession, where oral tradition is passed on supposedly from one generation to the next generation, and what each generation teaches is infallible even if it's not found in the written scriptures? Absolutely. So what does it mean that the Antichrist sits in the temple of God? It means that he claims to have infallible authority to what? To teach. And everybody must obey what it teaches because it is infallible. Does the papacy claim to be infallible when they speak on faith and morals? Yes, 1870. The dogma of papal infallibility was proclaimed at Vatican Council number one. Let me read you a statement from a Roman Catholic commentary, the Jerome Bible Commentary. This is volume 2, page 102. They're interpreting what is meant by Moses' seat. The phrase is most probably a metaphor for the authority of the scribes to teach. And then they say, in rabbinical tradition, the interpretation of the law was carried on in a scribal tradition that theoretically went back through an unbroken chain of scribes to Moses. This view, and then they say this view, of course, is entirely unhistorical. But of course the view that in each generation the papacy passes on from one generation to the next, of course that's not unhistorical. Only with the Jewish nations it's unhistorical, but not with the Roman Catholic system. Are you understanding the parallel? Now, it says that he claims to have absolute infallible authority to teach on faith and morals. He sits in the temple of God. What does that mean, he sits in the temple of God? What is the temple of God? Well, let's read the verse. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 4. We're still in verse 4. Wow. We've been dedicating a lot of time to verse 4, haven't we? There's a lot to say when you study phrase by phrase. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Is only God infallible according to the Bible? Yes. So if this system claims to teach infallibly, are they claiming to have the prerogatives and power of God? Absolutely. Now, what is the temple that this man of sin or this son of perdition sits in? You know, if you've asked an evangelical today, they'll tell you, well, you know, the temple that that this Antichrist sits in is a rebuilt Jewish temple in the Middle East. You know, this nasty individual, this blasphemous atheist perhaps, is going to, you know, build a temple, and he's going to sit in the temple literally upon a throne, and he's going to persecute the Jews for 3.5 literal years, and some even say he's going to build this great big statue of himself, and he's going to tell everybody to come and worship at the statue, and when they're worshiping, the statue's actually going to talk, and he's going to put a tattoo on people's forehead or on their right hand. You know, all of this is really a spiritual interpretation, isn't it? It's a totally material interpretation, a Bible prophecy. It's not what Bible prophecy teaches. But they say, it says here that the man of sin sits in the temple of God. So the temple of God must be the Jewish temple. Not if you study the Bible carefully. Do you remember the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem? Matthew chapter 21, verse 12 and 13. I want you to notice how Jesus referred to the temple. It says, then Jesus went into the what? The temple of God. So was the temple, the Jewish temple, the temple of God, when Jesus went in the last time at the end of the triumphal entry? Yes. It says, Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all those who bought and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, listen carefully now, it is written, my house. So was the temple Christ's house at that time? Yes, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a what? A den of thieves. In other words, you've made my temple a money-making proposition. Boy, I think that might have something to say about the prosperity gospel that's being taught today. So when Jesus entered the temple, it's called the temple of God, and Jesus calls the temple my house. But then Jesus pronounces in Matthew 23 the woes on the scribes and the Pharisees. And at the end of the chapter, Jesus leaves the temple, and I want you to notice what he says. Matthew 23 and verse 38. He says, see, your house is left unto you desolate. Why was it left desolate? Because Jesus left the temple and he was the Shekinah. So when Jesus left the temple, when the Shekinah left the temple was left desolate. And then what happened to the temple? It was destroyed by the Romans in the year 70 because it no longer had any Shekinah, because the Shekinah had been rejected by the Jewish nation. Now, it's interesting to notice that whenever the Apostle Paul uses the word temple, the word naos, he never uses it to describe the Jewish temple, the literal Jewish temple. You have all of the references here in your syllabus. 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 17, 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20, 2 Corinthians 6:16, and Ephesians 2:21. Every time that Paul uses the word temple, the word naos, it refers spiritually to the Christian church, never to the literal Jewish temple. And even more telling is that this word, the word naos, is never referred to refer to the spiritual temple of God in the book of Acts. In fact, in the book of Acts, we find that the word temple is referred to 25 times, and it's never called the naos. It is called by another Greek word, hieron. So what I'm saying is that whenever Paul uses the word temple, it's the word naos in Greek. Whenever it is used in the book of Acts, 25 times in the book of Acts, the word that is used for the literal Jewish temple is not naos. It is another word, hieron. So basically in the New Testament, the word naos is never used to describe the literal Jewish temple. Now, let's notice one example, Ephesians chapter 2 and verses 19 to 22. Ephesians 2, 19 to 22. So you see how the Apostle Paul understood the temple. It says there, he's writing to the Ephesians, of course, "Now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets." Are those spiritual foundations or literal foundations? They're people. It's not stones. They're individuals. So it says, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the what? Chief corner. Is this a literal stone that we're talking about here? Or is it a spiritual stone? It's a spiritual stone. It's Christ. The chief cornerstone is Jesus. Verse 21. In whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a what? A holy temple in the Lord. By the way, it's the word naos, which is the consistent word that the Apostle Paul uses to describe the church, the spiritual temple. In the book of Acts, naos is never used to refer to the Jewish temple. It's always used, a different Greek word is used, the word hieron is used for the literal Jewish temple. Now, notice what he continues saying. Verse 21, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. So what kind of foundations does the temple have? Literal or spiritual? Spiritual. Apostles and prophets. Chief cornerstone is whom? Jesus. Now, and we are the stones that are built up, because it continues saying, in whom you also are being what? Built together. And who is the Shekinah? For a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. What is the Shekinah today that dwells in the temple of God, which is the church? It's the Holy Spirit. Is the Holy Spirit visible or invisible? Invisible. Was the Shekinah in the Old Testament visible or invisible? It was visible. So are you understanding this? Is the temple of God the literal Jewish temple, or is it the Christian church? It's the Christian church. So where would we expect a man of sin to sit? In a rebuilt Jewish temple, or even within the church? Within the church. By the way, every single Protestant reformer, Luther, Calvin, Zwingli, etc., believed that 2 Thessalonians 2 was talking about the papacy, without exception. If Martin Luther resurrected today, he would die of a heart attack when he saw the Lutheran church making overtures and signing agreements with the papacy to celebrate the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. If John Calvin resurrected today, he would die of a heart attack. John Wesley, Zwingli, all of these reformers said 2 Thessalonians 2 applies to the papacy, sitting in the midst of the church, claiming to represent God on earth. How far has Protestantism gone away from the teachings of Scripture? So in conclusion, the man of sin who sits in the temple of God must sit within the Christian church. The link between the little horn and the man of sin can be clearly seen by the fact that the little horn or the beast speaks blasphemies against the Most High and demands worship. And here's an interesting little tidbit. It is hardly a coincidence that Pope Benedict XVI, and you can Google this, by the way, at the conclusion of the Week for Christian Unity in St. Paul's Outside the Wall, which is a very famous temple of the Roman Catholic Church, he sat on a great white throne. Does that sound familiar? He sat on a great white throne, and on each side of the throne was a cherub. Now you say, why is that significant? Because in Psalm chapter 80 in verse 1, it says that the Lord, Yahweh, sits between the cherubim. So symbolically, what Benedict XVI was saying is that he is occupying the white throne between the cherubim. Are you following me or not? That is blasphemy. Now, had Paul warned the Thessalonians about all of this? It should not have caught them by surprise, everything that he's saying, because we're told in 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 5, well, we finally got to the end of the passage, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 5, at least to the middle of the passage that we're going to be studying today. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? He says, folks, I taught you these things. How is it that you forgot so soon what I had taught you? And so this ends part one of our study. Was it clear? When you study phrase by phrase, is the passage absolutely clear? Yes. But now let me mention what we will study in our next lecture. In verse 6, we're going to meet a mysterious restrainer that is keeping the man of sin from being revealed in the days of the Apostle Paul. In other words, the Apostle Paul is going to write to them. He's going to say, you know, the man of sin is chomping at the bit, even in my day. He wants to show his ugly head. But there's something that is holding him back. There's something that is restraining him from being manifested. But he says the time is coming when the restrainer will be taken out of the way. And then the man of sin will be revealed in all of his fullness. So the question is, what is it that was restraining? By the way, would that mean that the papacy was in captivity? Restrained? Chained? We talked about this in the prophetic chain series. He was in captivity or chained, as long as the restrainer was there. When the restrainer is taken out of the way, then the man of sin is what? He's free. He's released from his captivity. Another way of expressing it is that while he is restrained, he has a wound. But when the restrainer is taken out of the way, his wound is what? Healed. Remember we talked about this in the chain series? So, next time we will talk about the mysterious restrainer that was taken out of the way. And we will also go all the way down to the end of time when we're told in this passage that this Antichrist will even counterfeit the second coming of Jesus Christ and will be destroyed by the parousia of Christ's coming. We're going to notice that there's going to be a counterfeit parousia. There's going to be a counterfeit coming before the true coming. It is in this passage. The Antichrist will also have a parousia. We'll notice in chapter 2 and verse 9. But that we will study in our next session together. So I hope that this has been a benefit, and I hope to see all of you back at our next lecture tomorrow. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for what we've studied. We realize that there are many sincere, loving...